that I invite now to hear from you, Your Eminence, what you have to say to us on this joyful day.
Your Excellency, Monsignor Muradian, Your Excellencies, Bishop Nicholas Sandri and Monsignor Abdallah Saidan, Maronite Bishop of Los Angeles.
And I cite now His Excellency Archbishop Gomez, the Metropolitan Archbishop of Los Angeles, after the bishop, because I'd like to express him a special honor. Dear Archbishop, we are very grateful to you and very happy because yesterday you attended the Divine Liturgy in the Melkite New Cathedral in Los Angeles. And today you can celebrate with us in this divine Armenian liturgy for this new cathedral of St. Gregory of the Illuminator here in Glendale. I like to express you the sense of the Congregation for Oriental Churches for your attention, your care, your closeness with our bishops, and for the Oriental people in general. You know that you are the pastor of one of the most important archdioceses in the world, with a great arrival of people from all over the world, from the Middle East, from the Far East, from South America, from Central America, and you have, even in this so great complex of problems and difficulties, this personal attention, presence. Thank you for all that you and the Archdiocese of Los Angeles is doing for our bishops, for our priests, and for so beautiful Oriental Catholic communities here in Los Angeles. Dear fathers, dear religious women, sisters and brothers in the Lord. First of all, I thank the Lord for having granted me the privilege of being with you on this beautiful occasion to celebrate solemnly the relocation of the Cathedral of Your Eparchy here in Glendale. The Cathedral is the see of the bishop, the primary place where he celebrates divine liturgy for his faithful. In this is place where the Christ experience of a believer deepens because of his day-to-day encounter with the Lord. He invites him to be immersed in the mystery, and to experience the salvation Jesus came to bring through his birth, death, and resurrection. The cathedral building throws light on the essential relation between the bishop and the faithful, the flock entrusted to his care by the Lord. The bishop is called to be a living image of good shepherd. Therefore, dear brothers and sisters, with your father, the Bishop Muradian, we can think of today's celebration as a family feast. The bond of communion that exists within the family is not only on the level of the bishop with the priest and the faithful, but also all our brothers and sisters who proclaim the name of Jesus Christ in every part of the world. His Excellency Monsignor Muradian has just returned from Lebanon, where the funeral rites of late Patriarch Mercedes Pedros were held. In the just concluded Synod of the Armenian Catholic Church in Beirut, His Beatitude Gregory Peter XX Gabriel was elected as the new Patriarch. His enthronement ceremony will be celebrated next Sunday. According to the ancient tradition of the Church, as soon as he was elected, the new Patriarch was granted ecclesial communion by the Holy Father, Pope Francis. This is a sign of a deep connection with the family of all believers who proclaim the name of Jesus in every part of the world. In this Eucharistic celebration, we will renew this connection to this family and commit ourselves to testify to the beauty of praying every day for each other. Living in the Church encouraged us to prepare ourselves for the visit of our Holy Father Pope Francis to the United States in just over a month. He is a witness and servant of the Union, of this Union. We are invited to join our Holy Father through our prayers and presence during his visit for the 8th World Meeting of Families in Philadelphia. His presence for this great event will be a special occasion, not only for the celebration of the joy of coming together as a family, but also for reflection and prayer in preparation for the second part assembly of the Synod of Bishops next October about the family. The letter of St. Paul to Corinthians that we have heard invites us to reflect on the two ways of being on a journey. On the one side, we heard about the story of the people of Israel who crossed the Red Sea and find themselves in the desert. They complain against Moses and against God. And thus they see. They lost faith in their God. They love them and care for them in the face of the adversities. On the other hand, we have the image of an athlete who runs for glory, and the glory for which he runs is the person of Jesus Christ. The suffering, hard work, and pain are nothing compared to gaining Jesus as his Lord and Master. In other words, he is totally taken up, possessed by the desire to experience Jesus. He is illuminated by the glory of God, which is a foretaste of the eternal glory that awaits him and each one of us. All this made me think about your history, the Armenians, whose journey is marked by the signs of life, certainly, starting from the baptism as the first Christian nation, passing through the martyrs and saints. One I remember particularly is Saint Gregory of Nareg, proclaimed doctor of the Universal Church on 12 April this year by Pope Francis. The Armenian people had to keep themselves on the journey. I cannot forget the three tragic events of the last century and other episodes during his history. The Armenian diaspora is rich everywhere in the world, and our Eparchy here is a living symbol of this journey. A great number of Armenians today are an integral part of American society, contributing to his rich diversity. Throughout the centuries, your people were able to put into practice the challenging invitation of St. Paul, going through struggles, hardships, and sufferings like the athlete in the stadium. You were able to overcome every hurdle without losing the treasure of faith, because you were able to fix your gaze on Christ, who overcame death on the cross. Like St. Paul tells us today, it is not longest I who live, but Christ who lives in me. Let us ask the Lord for the grace to be conscious of this great history and to be intelligent interpreters of it to the present, to reconstruct and to reconcile. Keeping in mind these thoughts, I would like to give you an image from the Word of God. I ask each one of you to ponder it in your heart and to make it become a personal experience in life. I refer to the 28th chapter from the book of Genesis. Jacob is heading to Haran, and on the way he stopped at a certain place where he slept, keeping a stone under his head. This was a sign of his destitution and poverty, of his being exiled after having lost everything. In sleep, he had a dream in which he saw a stairway resting on the earth, with its head reaching to heaven, and the angels of God were ascending and descending on it. Their God promised him that he will protect him and accompany him wherever he goes. Walking up in the morning, he took the stone and erected it up as a pillar, as a perennial memory of the meeting with the Lord, anointing it with oil. He named that place Bethel. Through this vision, God gave him the grace to perceive the truth that the house of God, his unique and stable dwelling place, where all human uncertainties will disappear. So, dear brothers and sisters, I wish that this cathedral represents for each one of you the stone of Bethel, the sign and guarantee of your fidelity of God. My thought at this moment goes to the innumerable stories of suffering, destruction, tragic death and exile of our brothers and sisters in the Middle East, where the origins of most of their families are rooted. God has not forgotten his children and listened to their cries, and desires to reach out to them through our presence. We can be messengers of peace throughout our prayers, like the angels in the story of Jacob, to ascend to heaven and implore for our brothers and sisters in order to descend on earth to show them God's living presence throughout our acts of charity. In this way, you remain grafted to Jesus Christ, who brought about through his death on the cross the reconciliation of the human race with God. Pray for us, Mary, our Mother and the Mother of God, who with her yes has offered to the world Jesus Christ. Let us invoke with the same words of St. Gregory of Nareg, quoted by the Saint Pope Francis, in whose name I will give you the blessing. O most pure of virgins, first among the blessed, mother of the unshakable edifice of the church, Church, Mother of the Immaculate Word of God. Taking refuge beneath your boundless wings, which grant us the protection of your intercession, we lift up our hands to you, and with unquestioned hope, we believe that we are saved. Dear brothers and sisters of this Armenian Eparchy, Catholic Eparchy of Our Lady of Nareg, please lift our heart and with all your enthusiasm continue to build this great and so beloved communion of Armenian community in Los Angeles with the intercession of the Holy Virgin Mary of Nareg.